Grandview Heights Secondary is a new three-story secondary school designed to house 1,500 students, featuring a multi-story circular entry focal point, two gyms, two sports fields, and 176-capacity theater. Opening in September 2020, Grandview Heights Secondary will address the overcrowding at Earl Marriott Secondary and Semiahmoo Secondary, with these two schools currently a combined 700 students over capacity in a rapidly growing area. To prepare for the opening of the new school, new catchment boundaries need to be established to balance student capacity at the four South Surrey White Rock secondary schools. This review will include an analysis of choice program locations as well as the natural feeder elementary schools for secondary schools. How do we accommodate student growth in the South Surrey White Rock area while balancing current enrollment and longer-term growth? In preparing these four options for proposed catchment boundaries for Grandview Heights Secondary, the school district ensured that we followed board policy, minimized disruption to students, made sure that we were close to feeder secondary schools, maximized existing space in all four South Surrey White Rock secondary schools, looked at long-term sustainability, and minimizing the crossing of major roadways. In particular, we followed board policies 9200 for school catchment areas, 9320 for registration and placement of students, 8320 for programs of choice and focus programs, and 5401 for board-owned buses in laying out these options.
Hi, my name is Kelly Isford-Saxon, and I'm the manager of planning and demographics here at the district. I'm taking over the slideshow from this point forward to discuss the context and all the growth that we're experiencing in our neighborhoods, plus also going into more detail about the four options that we're proposing for public consultation. So let's begin. Slide, projected enrollment, psst, it's all growth. It's true, it's all growth. The next slide, the map of South Surrey and White Rock, begins to show the entire area and all of the land use plans and changes that both the City of Surrey and the City of White Rock are contemplating for the area over the next 10 years. As you can see in this slide, there is a large pink line which signifies Highway 99 that divides the two communities. The following slide, the City of Surrey land use plans for the east side of Highway 99, focuses on all the NCPs, or neighborhood concept plans, that the city is currently contemplating in the creation of Grandview Heights. I want to draw your attention to Redwood Heights NCP number 5. That NCP is going to be in front of City Council in August to be contemplated and adopted. If it is adopted, we're bringing in close to 13,000 people in terms of homes and units coming into that community over a 10-year period. Then in NCP 3, referred to as Darts Hill, we're looking also at the adoption of a plan, of the NCP plan, over the course of, well, the late summer and early fall of this year. And if the City Council adopts this, we're adding another 8,400 people. So over the next 10 years, we're looking at close to 24,000 people coming into our neighborhood. The other area I'd like to draw attention to is defined as the new elementary school site, that orange area, which is basically the Sunny Heights NCP. In 2017, it was updated, and part of the updated was in order to deal with developer demand who wanted to increase the density in the area because of the demand from our community to live in such a nice neighborhood. Before I leave this slide, I want to draw attention to the Hazelmill Golf Course development application. It's the brown section at the bottom of the map. The reason why I'm bringing your attention to this is that they're currently, which is the golf course who is the developer, looking at developing part of their golf course with 235 residential single-family homes. Currently, this area is populated by very large acreages and is very rural in nature. If this is approved by Metro Vancouver and the City of Surrey, this will begin to be the first step possibly change the nature and development in this area, taking it perhaps from rural to urban. And therefore, we're keeping our eye on this as the next area of potential future growth. Moving on to the City of Surrey land use plans on the west side of Highway 99 is that this particular area, South Surrey and White Rock, are both existing maturing neighborhoods. However, as you can see, there is a lot of plans moving forward in terms of densifying, again, areas that are very desirable for people to come and live. The first area is the King George Corridor. They're looking at more densification coming in the form of mixed use, which is generally having some kind of commercial residential in the bottom with residential on top. Then we look at the Crescent Beach update, which is sort of the peach area. That currently is an NCP in which the city is not only looking at improving access to the area, but also contemplating the impact of high water area coming forward. But also at this time, they're looking at the possibility of having a discussion around changing residential makeup, looking at maybe other forms besides just single family homes. The two other key areas, which is the Semiahmoo area and the White Rock OCP, both of them are looking at the development of what they call their town center. For example, Central Semiahmoo Peninsula, that town center area, that is going to be a key area in which we're going to see a lot of densification, typically in the form of high rises and apartments. Now we're going to move into the City of White Rock, who's just revised and adopted their official community plan, or OCP. Here, again, looking at the town center along sort of Johnson Street, just up from the White Rock area. They too are contemplating and requiring high residential apartment type residential units. However, that's going to be just concentrated in that sort of deep orange area, where you see mostly of the white area surrounding the ochre and the brown is established single family residential neighborhoods. What they're suggesting in this area, and they use the word gentle, is gentle infill. So what they're suggesting is not any dramatic change in terms of the current makeup of the neighborhoods, but looking at densifying some of the area through triplexes and duplexes, but not necessarily all in one area, but throughout the community. So to summarize all of the things that I have just said in the last four slides, what we have done in the 10-year projected housing count slide is look at the three existing secondary catchments and basically from all the land use plans begin to show in a very simple form how many homes are proposed to be built over the next 10 years. For example, in Earl Marriott, they're looking at close to 8,700 homes, which will be made up of one and two family dwellings, townhomes and row homes, and of course apartments. But the thing that you need to note is that they're looking out over the next 10 years, over 8,700 homes to be built, or 870 homes per year. This is taking into account the kind of growth that we talked about on the Grandview area. This is significant. At Elgin Park, we're only seeing just over 1,000 one to two family dwelling units proposed for that area. What I wanted to bring sort of your attention to this particular diagram is to see that Elgin Park right now is what we like to call a maturing neighborhood, which means that people have moved into this community. They've had a family, and now the children are probably aging out and moving into post-secondary in their own individual life. But mom and dad are staying in their home in the Elgin community, which means that we're not seeing an influx of a lot of young families coming into it because people are staying where they love to be. up on the bluff, looking at the water, walking on the beach. And so what we're seeing is a strong maturing trend, which is going in a downward direction. And finally, you have to look at Semiahmoo secondary area. Yes, it has a good composition right now of apartments and townhomes and one or two family, but it's certainly not at the rapid rate of development as you'd find over in the Grandview area. So these all become very important when we start to project and moving forward and looking at how many kids that we're going to have in the elementary and secondary system. So when we start projecting for secondary systems or secondary programs, there are probably three areas that impact how many children that we have coming into the secondary system. And in the slide that says 10 years projected grade 7 student population, that is one of our major factors. How many grade 7s are we going to have or are we projecting to have over the next 10 years in which we have to provide appropriate and suitable secondary space? As you can see, Earl Marriott, the solid portion, 355, articulates the exact or actual enrollment that we had as of this year in September. The shaded area is what we're projecting in the future. So we're going from 355 today and projecting to 613 students in 10 years. This is another indicator of that phenomenal growth that's happening at Grandview. The next one is Semiahmoo. We have 284 actual enrollment today, and we're projecting to grow to 334. Again, modest growth. But the third one, Elgin Park, we currently have 186 grade 7s actually enrolled today, and we're projecting only to grow to 204. In that particular bar chart, what we're demonstrating is the trend of the maturing neighborhood, meaning we're not seeing as many kids coming out of this particular area, which is important to note. So as I said before, there are different factors that we have to look at when we're projecting for secondary population. Obviously, grade 7 is one of them. The second ones that we take into account is the impact of actual growth coming in the form of all these houses that we're building. Not all houses necessarily always have elementary age school children. They can also have families who move in with secondary students who have never participated in our elementary system. And then the third that we're always conscious of is the private school. The private schools where they don't necessarily have a secondary component. So what we're finding is the private school children now enrolling into our secondary program in order to finish off their secondary program. So when you combined all three of those, we it allows us to look at what we're going to project out into the future. So when we look at our 10-year secondary projections, that's the next slide, you'll find what I've done is in 2017, I have listed actual enrollments for Earl Marriott, Semiahmoo, and Elgin Park. And below it, I've demonstrated the utilization, which is a simple calculation of enrollment divided by capacity. Capacity being how many chairs that we have. So when you look at utilization, you can see currently Earl Marriott and Semiahmoo in particular at 123 and 128%. We are far exceeding the capacity of our building. However, again, Elgin Park is below 100%, which is identifying that we do still have some space available. So when we project out 10 years and we look at these numbers, for example, Earl Marriott, we have 2,580 kids projected, which is almost double our current capacity. And as you can see, the utilization is 172%. Also, you look at Semiahmoo. It's also phenomenally growing, 136%. This is the territory where we start talking about extended day in order to manage this kind of surplus enrollment where we don't have enough chairs. Then I take you back to Elgin Park, We're at 1,054. Our utilization has dropped even further. Again, showing that the demand in Elgin Park, or that trend of enrollment going downwards, is extremely strong. So when we go forward and we prepare the kind of boundary changes in the thinking going forward to talk to the public about, we only have three enrollment management strategy tools in order to manage seat shortfalls, enrollment surplus, and all of those great things that we're talking about today. The first tool that we have is obviously the new school catchment. Fundamentally, what we're here to do is create a new catchment for the new high school coming on in 2020. As a school cannot exist without an actual catchment. And legally, if the catchment is dissolved, the school is no longer open. The second tool that we have are boundary changes. It's by making changes in terms of perhaps moving a feeder school, perhaps making a catchment larger or smaller in order to manage enrollment and move it to where the space is actually available. And then the third sort of tool that we have is looking at program moves. Where should they be? How best to use that space? And using program moves as a way of creating space. So that takes us to our first two options, our boundary options. So boundary options, new catchment, that's option 1A, and a program change, which is option 1B. New catchment 1A. What we're doing in this particular one is we're creating a new catchment for the Grandview Heights Secondary, and we're doing one boundary change of Jesse Lee going to Earl Marriott. So I bring up the map, option 1A, basic new Grandview Heights catchment. All of the blue area is what we're proposing for the new Grandview Heights Secondary catchment. All of the orange is the revised Earl Marriott, as due to the fact that currently Earl Marriott is made up of not only the orange section and the blue section. Okay? So we've created the new catchment in blue for Grandview Heights. We've reduced Earl Marriott. Semiahmoo has lost Sunnyside, which will now be a feeder school for the new high school. And the top portion of Jesse Lee that's currently Semiahmoo in this particular option would now feed into Earl Marriott. What we're trying to do is, instead of having Jesse Lee split between two high schools, we'll have all of the elementary grade sevens now feed into Earl Marriott. So there has been some modifications or reduction to Semiahmoo's catchment. But in this particular case, Elgin Park remains static. There will be no changes. In this particular instance, we are not moving the French immersion. It will remain at Earl Marriott. And the IB program, which is currently at Semiahmoo, will continue to stay at Semiahmoo. So that takes us to our new slide. In this option, what does projected enrollment look like? The first box is 2020. So when the school opens in September 2020, Grandview Heights, we are projecting that it will start off modestly at 848 children. We look at Earl Marriott as, because of the splitting of the catchment, we will reduce Earl Marriott enrollment down to 1431. Semiahmoo will still be quite strong, but less. And Elgin Park will be 1,078 based on this particular boundary configuration. But if we project out to 2027, as you can see, Grandview Heights begins to grow because of all of that development that we anticipate over the next 10 years. Earl Marriott continues to grow, but now it's over capacity. It's operating at 117%. Semiahmoo may reduce, but again, we're at 100%. But I think it's important to look at the fact that Elgin Park now drops down to 88%. We're still seeing that trend of a maturing neighborhood starting to continue to affect future enrollment for Elgin Park. With this option, the next slide says catchments affected by this option. And these following slides, which are consistently shown with each option, are very, very important because they basically describe how this will affect your child if this change is made. So the first slide, which is important, all of the students that currently have an address within the Grandview boundary, when it's described, will automatically go to the new Grandview Heights Secondary. This is important. We need to start the school with children, all right? Where there's exceptions to this rule is in 2020, again, in 2020 September, if in your family you have a grade 12 student at either Earl Merritt or Semiahmoo and live in the Grandview Heights catchment, they can remain at their existing school and graduate with their grade 12 class. There will be no grade 12, the Grandview Heights Secondary, for the first year, which is the 2020-2021 school year. After that, they will have grade 12. Now, if you do have a student in grade 12 and they have a sibling in 2020 that will attend high school, the sibling, the younger sibling, will have the ability to choose to either stay at their existing high school, whether that be Earl Merritt or Semi, or they have the choice to go and move into the Grandview Heights Secondary. They have 1 year to make this choice, and that's important. I'd like to go to the next slide, which, how does this affect boundary changes for Jesse Lee? And what we're suggesting here, what will happen is, if this option is approved by the board, when we consolidate the Jesse Lee catchment, students that in 2020 do not have an older sibling in the high school, whether it's Earl Merritt or Semi, will feed directly into Earl Merritt. In the case where, again, in 2020, and the student in the Jesse Lee catchment affected, who does have an older student or an older sibling in Semiahmoo, can be grandfathered in order to keep the family together at Semiahmoo. That's important to know. As for choice programs, if you have a student who is in the French immersion program at Earl Merritt, they will remain at Earl Merritt, as that is the location of the choice program. All right, let's move to the second option. And this option is 1B. And what we are suggesting here is we're looking, obviously, at the creation of Grandview Heights Secondary. We're still supporting the possibility of a boundary change of Jesse Lee going into Earl Merritt. But what makes this option different is we're contemplating the impact of moving the French immersion program from Earl Merritt to Elgin Park, where it appears that we have some space. As for the IB program that currently is at Semiahmoo, that will remain at Semiahmoo. The IB program is unique because as part of their accreditation, they get accredited on both staff and the facility. So it will remain at Semiahmoo. So now let's look at the map, option 1B. Again, I go back and talk about the blue area. The blue area is the new Grandview Heights catchment, and it has not changed in terms of area based on the original 1A option. The same for Earl Marriott. And as you can see, Jesse Lee feeding down into the Earl Marriott, and the catchment now all feeds into Earl Marriott. The major change here is, in order to make the most of the space available at Elgin Park, we are moving the French program in its entirety to Elgin Park. We had contemplated the possibility of moving the French immersion program to Grandview Heights. But in light of the rapid growth in that area, it was going to have two major impacts. Or the possibility of two major impacts. One would be the in-catchment demand as this community developed over the next 10 years. The demand by the in-catchment children to attend Grandview Heights would begin to have an impact on whether we could maintain the French immersion program. And what that means is there's only two choices to deal with this. We would either have to continuously over time reduce the French immersion program in order to release seats for the regular stream kids, or maintain the program and move it back to Earl Marriott where there would be space. So therefore, we've always focused in terms of Elgin Park. So now we're going to look at the numbers, projected enrollment 1B. Again, I go back to 2020 proposed enrollment. We're saying, again, a modest sort of beginning of 848 kids in the Grandview Heights area. Earl Marriott, you can see the impact of losing that French immersion program. It takes it way below the 1,500 capacity that we currently have. Semiahmoo is still quite high. And Elgin Park. Now you can kind of see, by adding that French immersion program, not only do we use the space available, we put Elgin Park into an overcapacity situation. So we're at 128%. In 2027, you can see 1,300, the growth of Grandview Heights in that area. Earl Marriott obviously picks up because of growth happening within its catchment. Semiahmoo begins to drop down to be around 100% capacity, but Elgin Park maintains an overcapacity situation. So let's go back to, how does this affect your students or your child? And it's no different than what would happen before. All students that would be living in the Grandview Heights, no matter what grade or high school grade, would move directly into the new high school. Except for if you have a student in grade 12, they will remain at their existing high school, whether that's Earl Marriott and or Grandview Heights, or not Grandview Heights, Semiahmoo. If there's younger siblings within the high school program at the same time as 2020, will have a choice of either staying at their existing high school or moving over to Grandview Heights. Those things don't change. The next slide shows Jesse Lee. Catchment's affected, with Jesse Lee going to Earl Marriott again. Students in the affected area of Jesse Lee that would have attended Semiahmoo will now feed into Earl Marriott, unless, of course, they have an older brother or sister at Semiahmoo. And at that point, then they can follow their older brother or sister into Semiahmoo in order to keep the family together. What this option identifies, however, in the major change is, all students who are registered or about to go into the secondary French immersion program at Earl Marriott, instead of reporting to Earl Marriott, would now move in its entirety to Elgin Park. All right, so now we have two more options, and I'm now on the boundary options: Bay Ridge Move, option 2A, or Semiahmoo Trail Move, option 2B. What makes these two options different than what was previously contemplated is we're now looking at the Grand View, South Surrey, Right Rock area in its entirety. How can we manage this area for long-term sustainability? One of the key things when we're asking for space from the ministry, which is more classroom space, is that we have to demonstrate that we have used our existing area throughout the community. So if I have a surplus, or if I have a lot of children in one school and we're over capacity, it's assumed that if the school next to it is empty, that we will move some of the kids for where we have not enough chairs to the place where we have a lot of chairs. In these two particular options, what we're trying to do is to try and even out the growth amongst the four high schools so that not one high school has to take on the burden of overcapacity, perhaps extended day, but the weight of growth is hopefully managed at all four sites with some equitability. So let's go to the Bay Ridge Move, option 2A. Again, a new school catchment needs to be created, but this time the boundary changes. So we're looking at the Bay Ridge Elementary, which is currently a feeder school to Semiahmoo, to now, in 2020 that is, move to Elgin Park. And White Rock, which is similar as being a split feeder school, half going to Earl Marriott, half going to Semiahmoo, will now all go to Semiahmoo. But there'll be no program changes. So the French immersion program will remain at Earl Marriott. So let's go and have a look at the map. The map for this 2A option, again, the blue signifying the same catchment for Grandview Heights. We have the orange denoting the Earl Marriott. But this time, as you can see, White Rock, the half that would typically have reported to Earl Marriott, will now feed into Semiahmoo. Jesse Lee in this option will remain a split catchment, with a portion of it going to Semiahmoo and the other portion going to Earl Marriott. The major change in this one is Bay Ridge moving to Elgin Park. And part of the reason of contemplating this is starting to deal with that downward maturing trend, in order that Elgin Park can continue, or we can reverse that trend and add more kids in order to have Elgin Park to now grow into the future and be sustainable. The space in particular in this area that we have available, it's Elgin Park. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to move a lot of the growth westward to make the most of all the existing space we have in hand. Again, French immersion to stay at Earl Marriott. So when we look at these enrollment numbers over a seven-year period, in 2020, Grandview Heights, again, 848. But now you can see Earl Marriott does not dramatically drop like those other options. Semiahmoo is not as high as 1,500. It's closer to its existing capacity. But now Elgin Park is 1,131, or 94%. We're starting to make that first change towards having growth begin to counteract that maturing trend downwards. But the important thing is, if you look over 7 years into 2027, not only does Elgin Park grow, it grows relatively over capacity, but still we have a suitable number of chair to student ratio. We have Semiamu sitting at 100%, and we see that Earl Marriott is also close to 100%. Now we're starting to sort of see that kind of, as I like to refer to it, is icing on a cake, that there's more evenness, that not one high school is accepting the burden of over-enrollment while another one is partially empty. So I'll take you back to the catchments affected by 2A. Again, the things that I had said previously about Grandview Heights is still the same. Everybody reports to Grandview Heights unless, of course, you have an older sibling in grade 12. That has not changed. What I said about Jesse Lee in the prior options applies to Bay Ridge. In 2020, if your child is going into high school and they do not have an older sibling at Semiamu, they will feed into Elgin Park. In the case where they do have an older sibling currently at Semiamu in 2020, then they have the ability to be grandfathered in at Semiamu and continue to keep the family together until their end of their education. I would like to repeat this for White Rock to Semiamu. It's the same concept. Again, Earl Marriott and district choice program students that are enrolled in French immersion will report to Earl Marriott. So, finally, that takes us to one of our last slides, which is the Semiamu Trail Move, or option 2B. And this is the preferred one. Again, repetitive. New school catchment. But this time, our Grandview Heights Secondary is a bit larger. Boundary changes. We're looking at where before we were proposing Semiamu, now we're proposing Bay Ridge, we're now proposing Semiamu Trail going to Elgin Park, White Rock going to Semiamu, and all of Jesse Lee going to Earl Marriott. There will be no program changes. Again, French immersion will stay at Earl Marriott. So let's look at the map. What's the impact of the map? Okay, we look at the blue. The blue area is Grandview Heights. But what we've done is we've added now to the Grandview Heights secondary catchment a portion called Dart Hill. So we've taken some of that that enrollment from the Earl Marriott and moving it into Grandview Heights. Earl Marriott remains the same. However, now we're looking at Jesse Lee, the entire catchment, now feeding into Earl Marriott. We have White Rock, that half that once reported to Earl Marriott, now feeding into Semiamu. But the major change here is all of Semiamu Trail that originally reported to Semiamu will now report to Elgin Park. Again, no program district changes. So what does the enrollment look into be in our preferred option? In this particular one, because the Grandview Heights catchment is a bit larger than before, we're looking at a bit higher of an initial enrollment coming forward. But Earl Marriott is now under capacity. We have Semiamu that's just over capacity, but now Elgin Park is sitting at capacity. So we begin to sort of spread that growth around. In 2027, obviously Grandview Heights grows to a much larger number, but again, you have to look at Earl Marriott. Earl Marriott is projected to be 1560, Semiamu 1232, and Elgin Park 1152. If you look at those utilization numbers on the bottom, 97, 104, 95, and 96, that begins to demonstrate that the growth is relatively even throughout that area, so no one high school is taking on the majority of the growth and dealing with those issues. It also says that we're maximizing the space at Elgin Park. And what we mean by that is the movement of the catchment of Semiahmoo Trail has enough growth to begin to adequately deal with that maturing trend that we're finding in Elgin Park. So Elgin Park is now sustainable. And all over each of those schools are somewhere in the 100% sort of capacity, which means not one of them has to deal with extended day and some of the other tools that are used to manage overflow and surplus enrollment. So getting back to that, catchments affected by option 2B. Everything that I have said about for the last three times about Grandview still goes into effect. That does not change. Jesse Lee to Earl Merritt, as in option 1 and option 2, the same idea about older siblings being at Semiahmoo allows the younger siblings going into the high school program to be grandfathered in. But if you do not have an older sibling at Semiahmoo, you automatically feed into Earl Merritt. And then the last section is Semiahmoo Trail to Elgin Park. In this particular case, again, Semiahmoo Trail would follow under the same rules as Jesse Lee. In 2020, if you have a student entering into the high school program, if there is no older sibling attending Semiahmoo, the student would automatically feed into Elgin Park. Only in the case of having an older sibling in Semiahmoo would allow the younger student to articulate into Semiahmoo. Again, choice programs, there are no changes. All French immersion program or students that make it into the or accepted into the choice program will report to Earl Merritt. So that concludes our four options. So I'd like to turn for a brief moment our attention to transportation. We are currently discussing in a very sort of big, fulsome way all of the students that are, that are attending a public school at the secondary level in 2020, we're determining which sites each student goes to. And until we have an understanding and it's approved by the board, our boundary changes, much of the planning and design work that needs to be done in terms of transportation, programs, staffing, and all of that, we can't even begin those conversations until we figure out or we agree to what where each of the students are going. Once that is done, then we can go into the next layer of discussion. And one of them, which of course is very important, is transportation and busing. There is a walk limit of 4.8 kilometers for each student. And the way that number is determined is the actual walking distance. So it's going down the road, turning left, turning right, that whole walking path to the school. And if that is greater than 4.8, then from your street, you will be eligible for busing. So people who live farther away than 4.8 kilometers will be eligible for busing to their assigned home secondary school. Decisions and changes and all of that around the current busing routes and stuff like that will not be done until January of 2020. So all current bus routes will be operating as they are currently until September 2020, when the school is online. We suggest that you go forward and you go to our district website about transportation and busing to get further information. The second part of this question is always public transportation. And what does that mean? So I wanted to highlight first that we, the planning department, meet with the planning or transportation planning department at the City of Surrey on a monthly basis. And I have made them aware of the potential boundary changes that we're contemplating. And we have started to do work in seeing the impact that it's going to have on the public bus service. In order for us, that's the district, to have influence or even be able to talk to BC Transit, we must first go through the planning department at the City of Surrey in order to make that connection. These conversations are in their infancy, and we're just starting to have them and sharing information. So when it comes to the transit, BC Transit and all of that, again, that will happen later on in the process as numbers become more known, and we actually know the boundaries that we're changing and all of that stuff. So that concludes my portion of the presentation. Thank you for your time. Bye-bye.
As part of the consultation process, Surrey Schools is hosting 4 community forums. The first is April 30th in the Earl Marriott Gym, with another one at Earl Marriott on May 14th. On May 15th, we are in the Elgin Park Theater, and on May 16th, we are in the Semiahmoo Secondary Gym. All of the community forums will run from 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. The consultation process will close on June 15th, 2018. Over the summer, we will prepare a report for the board to be presented in September 2018. The earliest final decision from the board may come in November or December 2018. To gather public feedback, the Surrey School District has reached out to parents in a number of ways. The initial letter to parents was sent out in mid-April, serving as a save the date for the community forums. Shortly after, information packages were distributed to students through the schools. The information package and news of the forums were also posted to the Surrey Schools website and pushed out via the Surrey Schools School Link app. We also posted about this on social media, particularly Facebook and Twitter, and on our online public consultation platform, PlaySpeak. We reached out to the media and ran a story in the Peace Arch News, and of course the forums themselves serve as a platform for feedback. There are a number of ways to provide feedback, including through the online public consultation platform PlaySpeak at playspeak.com/SD36CapitalPlan. You can also ask questions during question period at the community forums. You can fill out the written feedback form, which is included in all of the information packages. It's also available at the South Surrey White Rock Schools and at all of the community forums. We also have a dedicated email address, grandview@surreyschools.ca, and a traditional mailing address. Thank you, and we hope you enjoyed the presentation.